Okay, there's not a lot of children. This person has 12 children. So this underdog is a lot. Yeah, I still think it is worth it.
Thank you. Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Hello, babe. How are you doing?
Hello, Myrna.
I'm good. Hi, Toti. How are you?
Good, good.
Yeah. Amen.
Well, I have video. I'm going to see if this is the right song. Myrna.
Yes.
Is this song right?
I don't hear it.
Wait, coming up now. You hear it?
No. Wait. I hear some music, but nothing. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
That's it?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, I'll have it ready. You can hear it good?
I hear it. It could be a little louder, but if that's the best you can do.
You can play through one of the speakers?
No, because I will subject to the speaker when I come to the computer.
Oh, okay.
That's all the volume it down.
Yeah.
Okay, Myrna, how you doing?
Hi, Minister Larry.
Hey, Larry.
So how far. Doing,
all right. Let's see, you got you ready, huh?
Yes.
Yes. All right. All right. All right. So, the way to start off, you know, we're going to do the little introduction and then do prayer, and then. Do you want me to introduce Uncle Mort to do a song, or would you like to do it, Cousin Myrna?
It would be nice if you do it, yes.
I'll take care of that. So okay. What I'm saying is...
But the song will be played.
I got you.
It's my favorite song.
Okay. Yeah, I tried to get it on the harmonica, but it was pretty hard. And then I guess the Lord wanted me to play it so he can hear the words.
Okay. All right. Well, that's fine. So what I'll do is I'll introduce the song, and then I will say, following the song, you know, we'll be under the leadership of Cousin Myrna, and then we'll go from there. And then you'll give your part, and then I'll do the latter part with the workbook questions, and then we'll have open discussion. And then I'll ask people if they want to ask questions. They can direct them toward you or towards anybody in the group so that everybody will have the opportunity to answer, and it not just be geared, pointed towards you, it can be pointed towards everybody. That sound good?
Yes, okay. Thank you.
Okay. Hey, Sister Joyce, welcome back.
Thank you, it's good to be back. Hello, everybody.
Hi, Joyce, how you doing?
Hello, Joyce.
Good. Hi, I'm Toti. Hello. I didn't say hi to you, even though I saw you.
Hi, Sister Myrna.
Hi.
I miss all of you people.
And we miss you.
Yes, I always miss this group. I'm trying to get back on track, though.
Okay.
I have been reading the book and studying. Brother Larry, I guess the big talkers of the group are not here yet, huh? He must have gone off.
Who?
Brother Minister Larry. I said the big talkers, but not on yet, because no one's saying anything.
Yeah, he came on. He probably went off for a minute.
Yes.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening, Joyce.
Hi, Maureen. Hi, Joyce. Hi, Myrna.
Hi.
Hello.
How is everybody?
Pretty good.
Good.
Holding on.
I was watching Marva's revival.
Oh.
Yeah, tonight was the last night of their revival.
Okay.
And then they had baptism. They baptized, I think, 11 people.
Wow.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Are they back in the sanctuary now?
Actually, this week, the baptism is, they're doing a soft reopening.
Yes.
So they started with the 3 nights. And then I believe that they're going to try the end of the month, the last Sunday, to go back into service again.
Yes.
Yeah. So Marva and Ron went because Marva prepares the baptismal certificates. So they're probably getting ready to be on the road around now.
Yes.
Hello, Larry.
Hey, Mom. How you doing?
You want to log on from the car?
Yes. So.
Hi, Joyce.
What was that, Maureen?
My brother logging on from the car.
I don't, she didn't say she would. Maybe she'll try.
Oh, I see, okay.
I think she thought she was gonna miss it. But you know, that may not be a bad idea for her to try to do that. Mm-hmm. If she has the information with her.
All righty. So everybody had a good day today?
Oh yes, very good day.
Very nice.
You know, we're on the we're getting near the topic of complaining, so I'm not going to complain.
I hear that, Joyce.
That's definitely part of my notes. I said, you know, we do that one all the time.
And this evening I listened to Reginald Sharp, and that was the last thing they said about, you know, if you're about to complain, then just thank God. Think about
it. Right. Think of something to be grateful for. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Right.
Oh, I tell you, we've been getting so much disturbing, unsettling news.
Yes, we have. Wow. Ooh. I think it's a test. We're going
I guess we are in the test mode right now.
Good evening, Joel.
Good evening, everyone. How are you?
Good evening.
How are you?
Doing well. How's everybody else?
We're all good. Doing well.
All good. Thank you.
Yes. Yes.
Missed you last week, Joyce.
Yes.
Missed you last week, Joyce. Oh, Danielle.
Oh, yes. I miss you all, too. I really miss you all. I really did not want to miss that class, but I had to go to that other meeting, and it was started at 6 o'clock.
Wow. Sometimes it be that way.
Exactly.
Yeah, two Wednesdays in a row, something was happening, and I just could not make it, but that won't be happening anymore. I said, we'll just, once this year ends, we'll be back on track, I hope.
Mm-hmm. Hopefully. Yeah. I hope so.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, only meant for a year.
See what Brother Larry has to bring.
Brother Larry, you know, I really be wanting to see those lessons that I missed. You never gonna put them on YouTube.
I do sometimes. I can send it to you.
I thought you post them on YouTube. Maybe I'm not.
So I haven't posted every single one of them.
You posted some though?
Most of them I have. Most I do.
Okay, well, I haven't looked lately, so I'll have to go back and look.
Yeah, okay. Recently I added maybe 7 or 8 of them. So, and I'm going back because I just figured out how to do it at work, because my laptop here didn't have the capacity to make it easy, you know, for me to do that. So I would have to download it onto another hard drive and then go from the hard drive to YouTube. But now I know how to go straight from Zoom to YouTube.
Wonderful. So what's the title that I look for? Minister Larry Johnson.
Yeah.
Okay. And it's a lot of Larry Johnsons though. But I'm
there's a few of us. See, there's a Pastor Larry Johnson, there's a Bishop Larry Johnson. So it may take a minute. But I usually try to put the Rock of Truth as one of the indicators that, you know, that's me. The
All
Rock
right.
of Truth.
Hi, Tommy.
All right.
Hi.
Hi. Marva is on too.
Good evening. On too. Michelle, her phone off. It's not on yet.
Yeah, it's on mute.
Yeah, I see Marva coming in.
I guess because she's on the road. Yeah. You know, and she don't want to have that background noise from the
freeway. Well, that's good. She can hear it. We know that they're with us in spirit, mm-hmm. and they're going to participate from where they are. So, good. Maybe one more minute or two more minutes, because Brother Elton hasn't jumped on. Give him a second.
Okay. Marva says that they're heading home. Mm-hmm. And listening in, greetings to everyone. Love you
okay.
all.
Yeah. Safe. I'm gonna drive safe, most of all, most importantly. If you guys hear us, y'all drive safe.
Okay.
Amen.
Yeah. So today, yesterday I visited with Dad, and we were, you know, hoping that he can get home for Thanksgiving. And he may or may not be home permanently for Thanksgiving, but I'm confident that he could come home for the day, at least for Thanksgiving Day. Right. Yesterday, he and I went out for a walk, and this was the first time that he's really been outside of a facility besides the patio area that they have this facility. And like since he went to the hospital the first time. So we sat out for close to 2 hours and he soaked up the sun, listened to music, watched the kids play at the school. We went to Shattuck and he watched the cars and the buses drive by. And, you know, just I could tell that he enjoyed it because I asked, Dad, you ready to go in? Not yet. You know, he may have been tired, you know, because when I came to pick him up, he was doing physical therapy. Which he was doing much better at as well. Before he couldn't really bend over. Now he's bending over pretty good. His flexibility is getting a little bit better. He has swelling on his feet. Now swelling on both sides has gone down. The main thing that he's trying to do now is heal the bed sores. And once that's done, then he'll be able to go home. So that's the update on Pops. He is getting better. Isn't really eating consistently like we would like him to, but on occasion he'll eat a full meal and, you know, just like a meal like you and I would eat. And
yeah,
but if he doesn't want to eat, he just won't eat, you know? And so, you know, it's not the, the desired results that we're looking for, but he is making progress. So,
That's good.
That's the praise report, the update on Pops.
Amen.
Look, you know what he wants. Get a man his milkshakes. Stop playing.
Not far from there where they do whatever kind of milkshake you want. His favorite flavors are, you know, for anything. Like he likes coconuts and he likes pineapples on anything, like pineapple cake and German chocolate cake, anything with coconuts on that type of stuff. So I got him a coconut milkshake and he knocked that down. The other day I had a pineapple mixed with strawberry. He knocked that down. So, you know, we got his milkshake diet going consistently because it's calories. And some of the things that we try to do is get him as many calories as we can because that helps build his weight up because he's real frail right now. The doctor was like, if you'll drink that milkshake, go ahead, get it as many calories as you can in it. So
awesome.
He has a steady diet of milkshake.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Well, that's a beyond for him. But thank you.
Yeah, we play the Raiders too, so.
Right.
Yeah, so with that being said, we're confident that I can't take him probably by myself, but if I get Ivan and Malik, you know, to help me getting in and out of the car up the stairs into the house, then I think he can come home for Thanksgiving, even if it's not permanent, you know, the permanent stay. He can come home and have dinner and maybe even stay the night and then the following day go back to the facility.
That's good news. Good news. Yes.
Well, if Brother Elton jumps in, then he can go ahead and jump in. It's 10 after. I don't want to belabor the time. We can go ahead and get started today. We're going to be led by Cousin Myrna, who is going to be teaching us how, helping us learn how to tame our tongue with regards to the complaining tongue. Every one of us can use work on this without me telling y'all everybody business, because I'm sure you guys will have something to share, but I'm sure all of us on occasion complain. And even if we're complaining about things to ourselves, it's still we still do it. So I'm sure this is going to be an interesting study today. This is day 23, and we're nearing the end of this study of the Taming Your Tongue series. It's 30 days and we're on day 23. What I'd like to do is, as far as the order of tonight, I'm going to open in prayer today. And then we have a song, one of Cousin Myrna's favorite songs that she thought was appropriate to this this topic that we're talking about. Then we're going to share the song. And following that, we're going to get our instruction from Cousin Myrna. And then we're going to end with few questions from our workbook and the open discussion. So with that being said, if everybody will close your eyes and bow your head with respect to the Lord as we pray. Our Father and our God, the Almighty God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the dream maker of Joseph, the I am that I am of Moses, and the Father of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, we come to you right now because you said, if we have any petitions, if we have any requests, if we have any problems, all we have to do is come to you. Yes. And Lord in heaven, we're talking about complaining. And Lord in heaven, we don't come to you with a complaint, but sometimes we do come to you with requests. And we know that you answer these prayers. So as we go through this study tonight, help us to discern the difference between a complaint and request. And if we do come to you, we know that we're coming with a legitimate claim or a legitimate petition or a legitimate request.
Yes.
You said that you'll answer our prayers if we come to you, and we have not because we ask not. So we're asking that you'll be with us right now and that you'll continue to be with us as we move through this journey called life. Help us to be able to tame our tongue and not complain, not complain to the wrong resources. So Father, if we have any complaints, we should come to you, the person who can answer all of our prayers and give us what we need. And Lord in heaven, tonight, as we go through this study, we're asking that you will be with our leader tonight, that you will use her mouth, her mind, and her spirit to be able to deliver a word that's going to help us lead this study better than we were before we came in. We know that she is capable, she is able, and we know that you're capable and you're able. So right now, we're asking that you allow your best to become her best, and that supernatural things will happen, and that this journey that we're going to go through in this next hour or two will be a great one, and that we'll be better because of it. So thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for answering this prayer, and thank you for pouring out your blessing to us for us to receive. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
So now we'll play the song. I don't know if there's an introduction to the song, Cousin Myrna, or we'll just get it once we hear.
Yeah. It's just a song that I sing, only the Lord hear me. I sing it every night before I say my prayers. So It's just a song that I like.
Okay.
I'll be playing it. I'd like everybody to mute the mic so they can hear.
Thank you, Uncle Mark.
Joy, my King.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. God.
I see why you love that song, Cousin Myrna. It's a beautiful song.
I love it. Yes. It's short and sweet. That's it.
Yes, yes. Yeah, I can see why.
Thank you.
So, and you know what? It is definitely appropriate because the opposite of complaining is to have gratitude, and you worship the Lord when you have that gratitude, that attitude of gratitude. So
it is definitely okay. Yeah. Okay.
So now I'll hand the mic, the stage over to you and allow you to have the floor for now. And then we'll tag team after you finish your presentation.
Okay. All right. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Tonight, we are going to discuss the complaining cow. The Webster Dictionary says, complaining is to express dissatisfaction, pain, uneasiness, censure, resentment, grief, and to find fault. It goes on to say about the Bible, complaining about your circumstances is a sin because you don't give God a chance. Memorize this truth. Do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless children of God. Philippians 2, 14 and 15. Let's see what else the Bible says about complaining. The Greek word translated complainer means literally one who is discontented with his lot in life. It is akin to the word grumbler. Complaining is certainly not a fruit of the Spirit. Galatians 5, 22 and 23. And in fact, it's detrimental to the peace, joy, and patience that come from the Spirit. For the Christian, complaining is destructive and debilitating personally, and only serves to make our witness to the world more difficult. Who, for instance, would be attracted to a religion whose adherents are dissatisfied with life and who continually grumble and complain? The first complainer was Adam, who after he and Eve disobeyed, complained to God that the woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree and I ate it. Genesis 3 and 12. The son of Adam, called Cain, also complained, although undoubtedly within himself. Genesis 4 and 6. We also know of the complaints made by Moses when he met God at the burning bush. Exodus 3 through 4. Also, Moses cried to the Lord repeatedly for deliverance from the Israelites' grumbling and idolatry. Exodus 17 and 4, 32, 31 through 32. We also know the complaints that David offered up to the Lord in the Psalms. Psalm 2 and 1, 12 and 1 through 2, 22 and 1. The complaints made by prophets concerning the idolatry of the Jewish nation. However, The book of Job offers the most in the way of complaints toward God. And yet, Job did not sin. Job 1 and 22, 2 and 10. That is not to say that the aforementioned people never sinned in voicing their complaints to God. But Job was a man who was able to sanctify his complaints. And that took humility. Clearly, as believers, we are challenged not to grumble or complain. Philippians 2, 14 and 15. 1 Peter 4 and 9. Rather, we are to love one another deeply so that we may become blameless and pure in God's eyes. If we grumble and complain, it shows how worldly we still are. James 4, 1 through 3. A complaining spirit leads to fighting and quarreling because complaints come from unfulfilled desires, which lead to envy and strife. Was that not at the root of the problem with the sons of Israel when they chose to dispose of their brother Joseph because of his dream? Genesis 37 and 3. While it is not wrong to complain to God, it is wrong to complain about God. Those that did so met the anger of the Lord, as was the case of Moses' sister Miriam, Numbers 12, and Korah and Dathan, Numbers 16. But note that they spoke against God's servant, and in doing so, spoke against God himself. If we must complain, let it be to him about our own sinfulness, so that he will forgive and cleanse us. 1 John 1 and 9. And put within us a new heart, one that rejoices rather than complain. I have a few scriptures, just a few, that I would like to read. 2 Timothy 2:16. But shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase unto more ungodliness. Ephesians 4 and 29. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. Psalm 141, 3. Set a watch, Set a watch, O Lord, before my mouth. Keep the door of my lips. Okay, I have one more. Okay. Thank the Lord for his forgiveness through Jesus for sins such as complaining. Let us guard our tongue and speak things which will bring glory to God and build our testimony to others of the blessings God has given us. And let us not forget, complaining is not a sin God takes lightly, for it shows that you are not happy with the plan God has for your life. The Bible calls it many things, including murmuring, grumbling, disputing, and vain babbling. This is a sin everyone deals with from time to time. We need to confess it, turn from it, and be content, knowing God is in control. Amen, amen, and amen.
Amen.
Good job.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Wow.
Yes.
Excellent job, Cousin Myrna. I mean, that was
amen,
so
cousin.
Word. Oh my God. I mean, it's led by
the word of God, and you can't go
exactly.
wrong.
Exactly. Exactly.
Right.
That's a sermon.
It's saturated. Exactly. It's plenty of sermons up in there. I see.
Uh huh.
Thank you.
I couldn't tell that this was your first time ever presenting. Really, I couldn't. Yeah, so
very first.
Great job.
Good job, Myrna.
You put that together very well.
Good job. Good job.
Very well. It was easily understood. So, I mean, I could have to tip my hat to you and say that, you know, you did as well as I've seen anybody who's a veteran teacher. I'm gonna raise my hand. You done just.
Amen. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
Wow. I hope you guys got all that, huh? Everybody.
Yeah.
good scriptures too.
Yes, I have
good scripture references.
Yes, so many scripture references, and you know, in the workbook and in the book reading, there are a few scriptures that are mentioned. But you provided so many more, and we can all go back and read upon those things and see what it says about complaining. And you gave us a hint what the scripture is about, but we can still go back and go read those scriptures in its entirety for ourselves later on. Wow. We're going to open up the discussion for open discussion. In just a moment, but what I would like to do first is give Cousin Myrna opportunity to say something before I start to go over the questions in the work. Is there anything else that you wanted to just say before I do that?
The only thing I want to say is what was in here about Romans 8:28. I know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. That is it.
That's real. Excuse me, God. That was one scripture that I had my notes as well. And that's right on time. See, that's that oneness of spirit that we have, in that the truth doesn't let anything take its power.
Mm-hmm.
So I had that Romans 12:2 in my notes as well. Wow. So you touched on a whole bunch of different reasons why we complain.
Mm-hmm.
And we all complain for different reasons. And there are different circumstances that cause for legitimate complaints, you know, mm-hmm. I mean, because there are some things that are legitimate complaints. And one of the examples given in the reading was the five daughters of, I forget his name. I don't want to say his name wrong.
Look at that name.
And
the name was
Zelophehad.
Yes, Zelophehad. There you go. Thank you, Mom. The five daughters of Zelophehad, they had a legitimate grief, and a legitimate complaint. And they did the right thing by going to the source.
Mm-hmm.
And what you did for us in giving us all the different examples of reasons why we might complain, or one reason why one might complain, all of it led back to the word. And that's one of the main points that I would like to point out, is that when we go to the one who can do something about the problem, that's when we've done the right thing. That's when we've taken the proper steps. And who is somebody who is in control of all things? It's the Lord. So we should take all of our problems, anything that we might think we might want to complain about, we should take it to the Lord because of that. And you also mentioned that when we don't do that, then we're not trusting that God can take care of what it is, whatever it is that's going on. And the five daughters, they went to the people who could do something about it. They went to Moses and the elders, and they got the desired result because they went to the right resource. So that's an example for us to go to the right resource if we have a complaint. and God is, he causes or allows all things to happen, then there's no third category. So we can go to him because he either caused it or allowed. So if we want to fix it, we go to the one who caused it or allowed. So that being said, there are a few workbook questions that I'm going to review. But before we do the workbook questions, and if anybody just does have a comment about any of the workbook questions, feel free, and we'll cover that question. But before we cover those questions, is there any comments that anyone would like to say?
I want to tell Marnish, she did not stray. It's the first time out of the whole book, out of 23 days, she did not pick no one that wasn't in the Bible. She stuck to every person that this whole thing was scriptures.
Yeah.
The whole thing. Girl, you awesome.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. And I thank those that helped me. They know who they are.
Okay. Well, one of the questions that are asked in the book is the question number two. It says, complaining is by far the most negative use of the tongue. I would tend to agree about that as well. I know it's one of my peeves. The other ones can be more irritating, but this is one that is probably the most prevalent because it's used the most. It can be contagious if we're not on guard against it. All it takes is one chronic complainer to change the entire atmosphere. How many of you guys have ever been in that atmosphere where everything was going good and one person, one bad apple came and spoiled the entire bunch? Sometimes we may not personally have a problem with a particular situation. However, to avoid hurting the complainer's feelings or to make that person feel we are relating to them, we may chime in and join in the grumbling as if we too are negatively impacted by the circumstances. Mm-hmm. If you guys have ever done that, I ain't gonna say you guys, but I'm gonna get in the front of the line and say how many of us have done that. So for the next 24, this is an exercise that we can do. And some of you guys may have read this workbook question before today and may have tried it. Or if you haven't tried it, maybe in the next couple of days, try going 24 hours and make a note of the various types of complaints you hear. And what do you find that most people complained about? Well, I did this exercise, but I want to open it up this question to see if anybody has anything to say about question number two. Question number two that asked if you've observed.
I would say that people mostly complain about money. They don't have enough money. If they're working, they don't pay them enough. They work hard and they give it, you know, they're working so hard, or maybe they think that somebody else working with them make more money and work less, you know. To me, that money is the one, number one, to me.
I think you might be right, I ain't told you. Yeah. Money, they say it's the love of money is the source of all evil. And complaining is one of those things that comes from having money issues. I couldn't have any argument against that. So anybody else have what you say about that?
Most people complain about other people.
True that.
Yes.
Well, that is why I chose the complaining day. Because I always feel that's what I get around.
She froze.
I wanted to understand it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes. complaint about anything at all. It's a lot.
Right now, Cousin Myrna, there's somebody right now complaining, saying, oh, I could have done it better than she did it.
Yes. Yes. Oh, gosh. But, hey, if you think, if you talk to the Lord, and since I started with the complaint, and I anytime I thought I would complain, it stopped me. Stopped me short. So yeah. I'm thanking the Lord.
Yeah.
This lesson tonight, when I read it tonight, you know, it let me think of what happened today on the job, because this morning they had a meeting and they were talking about people calling off, and you know, like in the retail, the people having a hard time to get people to work. And so this lady that was there was saying that if the people don't come to work, they have 3 strikes and then they will send them home. So that I look at the other girl and I say, in retail, no manager at this moment can fire anybody. They need you to be there. So a lot of people abusing, you know, they don't call, they come late, ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta, because they know that they're not gonna fire them. Mm-hmm. Because retail is struggling for people to go there and work, mm-hmm. you know? And when I read the talk, I say, and I was talking to the other lady, and then she starts telling me, she said, oh, but this one, she makes so much money, and she's never, that's why I say about, you know, the money, because it came to me immediately. She said she always complaining, she do whatever she want, she have so many years here, and they let her do whatever she, and I was there listening to all this, you know, and when I read the book, I get to that, you know, I said, oh my God, I fell right into that thing, you know, I felt it. Mm-hmm. So we got to be careful, because it can draw you in, you know?
Yes.
So you just stay out, keep your thoughts for yourself.
Yep. And like the reading just was saying that, you know, just to try to make the other person not feel bad, we may join in. And, you know, that's not a good excuse.
No.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Mm-hmm. Because we can mistake that as being empathetic or being sympathetic mm-hmm. towards what they're saying, but you know, to a certain degree, we have to draw a line in the sand and say, well, you know, we can be sympathetic, but not necessarily perpetuating the complaint.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, I had a really good, I would, like you said, that sometimes you have a good reason to complain.
Yeah.
Okay. And I'm going to give you my experience. Last Tuesday, when I was traveling back from California, and I'm at the airport in Las Vegas. I've been sitting there probably about an hour and a half waiting for my flight time. And my boarding was going to be at 3:20. And right about 3:15, at first I heard, you know, all of a sudden, a lot of people were coming in and sitting at that gate. And then I heard one lady says, this is the 4th time I've had a gate change in one day. You know, but they were talking to each other and I'm not, you know, just listening, but not paying that much attention. And I'm going on just doing whatever I'm doing. And it was just 2 of us sitting there in a wheelchair. Well, I'm just assuming that the lady next to me was getting on the same flight with me. And then I hear an announcement that the flight to Orlando, there's been a gate change. And I'm thinking, I really didn't hear correctly, right? So this lady said to me, are you going to Orlando? I said, yes. She said, well, that announcement is for you. And I was at gate C24. They announced a gate change to C2.
Ooh.
Las Vegas is a huge airport. There is nobody at the gate to help this lady in her wheelchair to get from C24 to C2. So the lady, the other lady says to me, well, let me help you. You need to get there right away. And I'm thinking to myself, This is going to be cute. So she helps me, reaches over from her wheelchair, helps me to get my carry-on. She helps me to get my carry-on on the wheelchair, and I put my purse on there, my cane, and I am pushing this wheelchair. I go out and I see these two men. I ask them for directions because I really didn't know which way to turn. And he said, ma'am, it's going to be that way. He said, but you, that's a long ways for you. I said, okay, I better start. I think it literally took me about 10 minutes. Mm-hmm. Here I am pushing this wheelchair. There's nobody to say, can I help you? Nothing. So when I make it finally, it looks like each time I got to one gate, it looked like C2 was getting further and further. I was in a mirage.
Wow.
And finally, when I saw C2, I mean, I'm just panting for breath, everything. And I get there and people are boarding and the place is crowded.
Wow.
And this young lady said, ma'am, are you a pre-boarder? I said, yes. And she said, well, they already got on the flight. She says, let me see if I can get you past this crowd. And she asked people to move aside so I could get through. I got to the gate and he took my boarding pass. And then I said to him, they changed gates on me 5 minutes before boarding time. And all he said was, okay, ma'am, I'll make sure you have a wheelchair at the other end, you know? And then, so I make it all the way down to the plane. And then I get on the plane and by this time it's getting full, but I was able to get a seat maybe in about the sixth row. And this nice gentleman who was at the window, he says, you know, go ahead and sit down and I'll help you. So he actually helped me with my seat belt and all of that. And then I text Narisa to let her know that I had made it to the gate. And I told her what happened. And she said to me, you need to file a complaint. But in my mind at the time, all I could think was, Lord, thank you that you allowed me to get on to the flight on time and still to get a seat. A decent seat, you know? And by this time, I mean, I was just, you know, so tired from that. Like Larry said, when I told him, he said, that was a slow O.J. Simpson. So anyway, I sat on the plane and all I'm thinking is I could have missed this flight only because they waited until 5 minutes before to change it from one extreme to the next.
Yeah.
And of course, I was so tired, I went to sleep. I slept most of the way. But I said, I prayed before the flight took off. And I said, Lord, thank you. Thank you for getting me here on time in spite of all that I went through. And then, because one time everything was falling off of the wheelchair and I had to try to get it back on. You know, I am hurting. My body is just hurting. And then I get to the other end and we got there on time. And I was getting ready to, I was open my phone to text Narisa to let her know that I made it in safely and everything, and to text Marva. And then I saw the news about one of my best friend's husband had just passed away, you know? And all I could do at that point was just pray for her. And I kind of sunk back into my seat because it took me by surprise. But I'm saying all of that to say that I could have just gone off on somebody. But I thought, what good is that going to do? Thank you that you allowed me to get here on time. And the next day, the very next day, I'm sitting in my bed, open my computer, and there's an email from Southwest asking me to rate my last trip.
Wow.
And you know what, though? I rated it. I gave them a good rating on everything except the Las Vegas experience. And I just made a suggestion that if they are going to make a gate change, that they should consider the seniors that are sitting there on wheelchairs mm-hmm. that will need help mm-hmm. and provide, you know, some kind of assistance, especially when you're in an airport where it is so large mm-hmm. that you really don't know which direction to go.
Right.
She's absolutely right.
But I thought to myself, Lord, that was a test.
Yeah.
That was a test.
Yeah.
Really a test.
Joyce. Unmute, Joyce.
Yeah, unmute.
Yeah. I'm so sorry. I'm just flabbergasted at your story. I thought that the whole point of wheelchair assistance is that yeah. they have someone assist you.
Exactly.
From point to point.
I had assistance from the plane to the gate. A very, very nice young lady.
No, I mean, if there was a gate change, they should have had someone assist you
exactly.
from that gate to the next gate.
There was nobody at that gate. Nobody. The only people at that gate were passengers, but there wasn't an employee at that gate at all.
But that's one of the problems that the airlines are having. They don't have people to work. People right. don't want to work. So they don't have people to do that job, to really help you out like how they should.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, I was telling the wheelchair assistant at Oakland that of all everywhere that I've traveled, I observe the way that they are with the customers. And I said, by far, Oakland is the best. Mm-hmm. Very best. I mean, he came to get me and he cleaned down that wheelchair real, real good. Nice. And he said, Ms. Jordan, are you ready? And don't worry, ma'am, I'll get everything for you. And he was just so helpful. Do you want to go get something to eat? Do you want to go to the bathroom? You know, the lady in Las Vegas, the young lady, was really, really nice. And she did tell me, she said, this is a large airport. So from where I landed, the gate I landed at, to where I was going to be, she said, it's a long ride. Mm-hmm. And it was a long ride. She talked to me all the way. And then I get there and of course, that's and somebody else. Mm-hmm. And so I am sitting there and she made sure I was comfortable and they had a lot of charging stations. So I was able to plug my phone in and charge it while I'm sitting there. And I'm so happy my phone is charging up good and everything. And then they wait until 5 minutes. Before.
Wow, I don't know how you did it. That was only God. Reverend Shaw used to say, but God.
Only God.
Amen. Yeah. Amen.
Only God.
The last time we traveled, it happened to us, but I did have each time they sent somebody. The very last time they changed my gate three times. Three times. I've never had that happen.
Wow.
But they sent somebody each time to take me.
Well,
each time somebody came and took me to the other gate.
Yeah.
I don't know what I would have done, Joyce. I don't know.
You know, one time that happened to Martin, to me. I didn't read this book yet, so I complained. And we got a first class seat.
Oh, yeah, man. I was going to ask Minister Larry.
Yeah.
Mr. Larry, now is that a legitimate complaint?
It is.
And is that one that you would only take to God?
No, that, I mean, so, no, to answer your question, to me, that's a legitimate complaint.
Yes.
And let me just, before I comment on your question, Sister Joyce, Mom, one of the things that is a learning lesson from this is you never know how strong you can be until you have to be. You probably wouldn't have never thought that you could do what you did ahead of time. If somebody would have told you needed to do that, you would have complained. You probably would not have done what you had to do, but you had to do it, so you did it. And you didn't know how strong you were until you had to be that strong. That was one thing.
the other thing is, it was one other thing that you said that sparked. It'll drop back in a second. But to answer your question, Sister Joyce, that was a legitimate complaint.
Yeah. And
if you went to the right resource instead of just complaining to the person next to you on the flight, is not good. That you shouldn't do that. But taking that complaint, filing a complaint, that's the word that you used. That Narisa said you should do. You should file a complaint.
Right.
That was legit. And if you go to the right resources in order to file the complaint and not just complain to everybody who will give you a listening ear, that would be a problem. But filing a complaint to the people who need to hear what happened, that I think that would be legit, in my opinion.
I agree, because I find that, even when I was working and, you'd pick up the phone and you'd say, good morning or good afternoon, AT&T, this is Joyce speaking. And then that person just lashes out at you. And that's because they needed to vent and you were the one that they got.
Yeah.
And a lot of times you really can't do anything to solve their particular problem. But if they would have just given you the opportunity to listen, and you could have at least lead them in the right direction, a lot of times people would say, well, I know I'm not angry with you, I'm angry with the company. Mm-hmm. So, like you said, you need to take it to the right person.
Source.
Like in the Bible, the five girls, sisters, they took that to the right source. Somebody that could really help them.
Hello. I finally got settled in. Can I add something?
Yes.
Okay. Joyce, we're doing the same thing like last night. Can you turn yours down a little bit? We're finding when we're in two different rooms, the computers talk to each other. But I was thinking, I agree with what you said, Minister Larry, about something being a legitimate complaint, and in Joyce's case it was. And then I thought about something she said when she got to the seat. She said, in spite of the fact that she was feeling, put out, she said, a nice man came to my aid that was sitting by the window, and he came over and put my things up and so on. And then there's a scripture that says, surely God will come to your aid. And I can't remember where it comes from. But I thought, you know what? When she was pushing that wheelchair all along and she got to that place, a lady stopped her and asked her, ma'am, are you a pre-boarder? That's what I heard her say.
Yeah.
And the lady helped her to get up ahead. So that was the first indication of God coming to her aid. And then when she got all the way in, the guy at the seat came to her aid. Okay. So when the Lord is coming to your aid like that, it kind of diffuses any anger or frustration you may be feeling. Mm-hmm. And you know what else he did? The next day she got that survey. And so she did have an occasion to complain through the survey. Maybe she didn't stop and file a formal complaint, but she had an opportunity, I should say, to complain through that survey. And she said she gave them a good rating on everything else except the Las Vegas airport.
Mm-hmm.
And see, so to me, that's significant. God came to your aid, but he still left you a window to handle that on this end while he took care of the spiritual side. And I was listening to what you were saying, and those are the things that came into my memory, that to my spirit, that God came to your aid in the mid, and he will do that in the middle of any storm, and that will help you to not go the extreme with the complaining, but to fall back and then handle it appropriately.
I don't mean to cut you off, Aunt Marva. Are you done?
No, I'm done.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I'm looking at the length of time that it took you, the distance that had to go in your age. When I first heard you tell that story, it's a famous poem. I don't know if you guys ever heard of it, but it's Footsteps.
Yes. Yes.
When you was telling me that, and I'm putting all three into the fact, okay, she's a senior. She's double digits, from 23 to 24. She's going from double digits to a single digit.
Two.
and you know what? And she's pushing something. She's pushing a wheelchair, and that's more than 10 pounds. And she's pushing that. So she got her age, the distance, and the speed.
Yeah.
And you know, when you look down and you only saw 2 feet, those wasn't yours.
That's right.
Amen. Right. You know, when you told me that, I'm like, man, if that's not a perfect example of the footprint, what it is.
Yep.
That was time. You know, we've been to the Vegas airport a lot. That's a distance. And you say you fell asleep. You didn't say you passed out. Fell asleep. So normally, with all three of those things, in fact, you would have passed out. Right there, you're like, okay, let me go to sleep. That was God carrying you.
Amen.
Yes.
I also heard her say that she kept saying, thank you, Lord, for forgetting me. In the midst of the storm, she was thanking God.
That's perfect footprint point.
Amen.
You lived it.
I didn't think about it that way, Tina, but you are so right.
Yes.
So right.
Only God.
But
I knew that I would have a chance to give this testimony because I did have a legitimate reason to complain.
But God was carrying you the whole time.
Yes, right. He was.
He never leaves you alone.
And this one I was thinking, as far as complaints, when you said you go to the person that can do something, that's frustrating when you're a union rep. Because for years I was a union rep, and that's all I was getting was complaint. But that was my job. But to hear complaints from your first phone call to your last phone call, and you know, you have to really have God as your eye on the prize.
Mm-hmm.
When you're hearing complaints all day long, sometimes you take that home.
Mm-hmm.
You really have to put God in the picture.
Amen.
All day long, when it's your job to hear complaints all day long. It had gotten so bad that I was saying, hi, this is Tina, how may I help you, to everybody. I'm talking cousins, brothers, mothers. Tina, if you tell me that one more time when I call you, your name and how you can help me, I don't want nothing. I just have a conversation, but every time I call you, go, hi, this is Tina, how can I help you? And then she corrected me. She says, how may I help you? So I said, okay, but I call you on the weekends and when you home from work. Don't answer the phone like that. And so I said, okay, I'm sorry. But when you hear complaints, it becomes a habit.
Mm-hmm.
And I already know what I'm talking about. It becomes a habit that you talking to other people, you expecting a complaint because that's all you hear. But the thing from reading this, I always took things to the Lord, but this book gives you three pages of why you should take somebody else but him. You know, so thank you again, Sister Myrna, because you brought everybody from the scriptures.
Thank you.
You just pointed out that there is nothing new under the sun.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Because everybody Amen. That was in the scriptures is over 2,000 years old.
Yes.
And yes. 2,000 years old. Yes. And they have the same things that we are seeing right now in 2021. This is
not Amen. Yeah.
And if they were able to find solutions in God, so can we.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Thank you. And Tina, that was my title at work. I was a complaint representative.
Wow. Okay, we here. We here.
That was my title.
You cheated.
But I took complaints from the clients. You know, I took complaints from Medicaid, food stamps, you know, that kind of stuff. Yes. Home care. Yeah.
Wow.
Yes.
No. Yeah. So you had an advantage right there, Cousin Merton, right? you have some expertise in that area.
Oh boy. That was something. But yeah. You learn, you know, as you go on, you learn how to control it and who to speak to about it. And it worked out to be one of my better jobs.
So let's cut to the chase. You were dealing with them low-income colored people, huh?
Yes. Yes. And they could tell you off, you know, but luckily enough, I have only had one person. You know, they'll call you with profanity.
Girl, you don't get my food stamps, girl?
Yes. They're for profanity. And I would tell them, listen, I am not here to hear that. And if you don't stop, I'll have to put you on hold. And hopefully when I return, you'll be calm. And most all of them will be calm. One guy, when I returned, he let out a whole slew of profane words. And then he hung up.
they didn't have nothing else to do all day. They didn't work.
But the other people wanted the help, so they composed themselves. When I got back on the phone, I could, you know, help them.
I love the way you knew that. That's a good response. If somebody is complaining to you, time out. Hold on 1 second.
Yeah.
You know, you're regaining control of the situation instead of buying into it or being sucked into it. Or responding negatively to it, that's a positive way to respond to it. Time out. Can I take a step away and then come back to it? That is an excellent response if we find ourselves in that situation. Even if it's not, you know, we're not at work, but in personal situations as well. You know, we're having a disagreement. Hold on, time out. Let's step away from it and then come back again.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You have to tell them, do you want a solution or do you just want to complain?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Yes. Wow. You know, one of the things that I thought about with as far as complaining, because it's one of my peeves that, you know, after a while, somebody complains so much that it just becomes like you become numb to their complaint. That's a very dangerous thing. And I thought about the story about the shepherd boy who cried wolf.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he was complaining, and when the wolf actually came and showed up, nobody believed that the wolf was there because of all the complaining or all the sin that he had been doing before. The same thing goes for complaining. When you finally do have a legitimate complaint, nobody ain't gonna pay you no attention because of all the other times you don't wore out your wealth.
Exactly right.
And so that can be very dangerous. As far as complaining is concerned. So I just wanted to make that one point.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is a really, really interesting one. It says that it is one of the worst tongues, is complaining.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. And we're also, you know, it's something that, you know, we have all done without even thinking about it.
That's it. It's something mm-hmm. that it just comes to you to do, you know, mm-hmm. like I should complain about that. And it's not, now we're learning that it's not a good thing to do. It's a sin.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
You know,
yeah, and how quickly we forget. Today, before going to the service, I had an ophthalmologist appointment. And when I got to church, I was talking to two ladies, and they said, one said, well, why are you here so early? I said, well, we went to the doctor before coming here. And she said, I said, went to my eye doctor. She said, oh, how is that coming along? And you know, there were two things that had two results at the eye doctor. One of them was my pressure was too high, which it shouldn't be. And the other one was that my single eye that's still working, that's only 10% vision, tested 20/20. That little bit of eye before still has it going. Wow. But wait a minute. I could have told them the story about the 20/20. You know what I said? I said, well, my pressure was high and I totally forgot about the 20/20. So I went back in and I finished getting a bite to eat. And one of the ladies came in and I said, Monique, wait a minute. I've got to tell you the best part. I didn't tell you the best part. I said, I chose. So see, that was a complaint. I'm complaining about the
pressure.
Yeah, the pressure. And I said to Monique, the good part is that my little eye is still seeing 20/20. so we both rejoiced about that. But you see how easy you can complain?
Mm-hmm.
I totally forgot about that. And I was really ecstatic about the fact that I still measured 20/20 up, you know, on my chest with that eye.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but we forget. And we just slip into that mode of, you know, oh, poor me, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So subtle, Auntie, you're right. Because somebody can give you a compliment. You'd be like, oh, this old thing right here, this old
thing.
You knock it down. Or you cut it in half, you know, and we do it all the time. And it's learning behavior as well, too. Because, you know, we could emulate people around us. And if people around you are complaining all the time, watch it, watch out.
Yeah.
Because it's gonna rub off on you. At my job, it is more complaining that happens. And some of it is legit. But the thing that I've learned from this study today is that most of the complaining goes to the wrong resources. Mm-hmm. We complain to each other when we can't. That's like Stevie Wonder trying to lead Ray Charles across the street. We have to go to the right resource, and that's one of the most important lessons that I've learned from today's study, is that we have to go to the right resources. Complaining is not just a total bad thing, because even the situation that happened with Mama Jordan, that was a legitimate complaint, but it's going to the right place to file the complaint. But just talking to anybody wouldn't have been the right thing. But that's what we do at my job, and I'm guilty of it. I don't do it like I used to, because you know, and people don't even approach me as much anymore, because I have shut it down a little bit. But for many, many, many years, I hear something from across the room. What'd you say happened? Oh man, I can't believe that happened. And I jumped into the fire with them, you know, into the pot with them. And now I do it a little bit less, but now I see how I have to be adamant about not getting involved with the complaint, because it, you know, it's a sin. It really is.
Mm-hmm.
And then here's the other thing. Sometimes people complain and then don't want to do nothing about it.
Mm. No.
That's the word for me. So my cousin, he's one of those that he finds a problem with everything. I ain't gonna say which cousin either, because it's like he'll know who it is, but he complains about everything.
Well,
you know, I think this, I think that. And he talks about some of the laws that come about, and he won't go vote. So
So I'm like, dude, you don't have, you can't say nothing if you're not gonna get out and go vote. What are you doing with complaining?
Yeah.
If you want to do something about it, then do something about it. Don't just complain about or, you know, have a gripe about it unless you're going to do something about it. That's one of the things that he does. He talks about every politician and everything that all politicians do, but then he won't go out and vote.
So no.
Time out. I don't want to hear that no more.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. The most common one that we see is, and we're going to see this a lot this week and next week, is people going to be complaining about the line in the store.
Yes.
So long, but this is a perfect example of people only talking to each other. When they have people that's cashiers and they don't have to yell anymore, now they could just pick up a phone and say, you know, could someone come and open up another register? But it's be a people in every line saying, oh, they're taking too long, or this line is too
patient,
it's too slow.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of going, and that's what she said here on page 98, where she said, instead of sitting there complaining, I went to the manager and asked him, could he open up another line?
Yes.
And now in the stores, we don't even need to go to the manager. Each checker has a phone.
Mm-hmm.
They can call themselves, but it is so common that while we line, this is taking forever. When it is somebody we can go to, but we talk among ourselves. And this is done daily. And if you don't believe me, watch next week.
Tina, that's why I went this week.
That's why I was last week.
Oh, Cousin Rhonda, we are here today.
And that's why I went today. That's why I'm here.
We went this
that's
week
why
too.
Late.
Yeah. Got back late.
You know the one thing that I go ahead, Mother Jordan.
Okay. No, tonight on the Daily Dose of Devotion, that's exactly what he was saying. What he was saying is that he was talking about giving thanks. And he said, we must remember that last year, we couldn't get together.
Mm-hmm.
This year, some families will be able to get together for the first time.
Right.
And he said, but we tend to forget about all these things. And we're so... Mm-hmm. You know, take so many things for granted, but we must remember to give thanks.
Amen. Amen.
That's what this is all about. You know, if you have any reason to complain, just remember how blessed you are. And that's Romans 8:26.
Excuse me?
Okay. This Romans 8:28 is a good one, where she reminded us that to select it from your favorite, your favorite Bible, and just study that, because we know that all things work together for good for those who love God. And but his little message tonight is also reminding me. I said, "Oh, this is really helpful," you know. That we're getting it from all sides, you know?
Wow. Brother Tommy, you about to say something?
In the workplace, I found out that the best thing you can do for a complainer is to give them responsibility. they become like Hitler. If you tell them, make sure all the girls have their apron on and they have their gloves on, they inspect everybody that comes to the machine. And then, I mean, and that stops their complaining, because you give them a responsibility.
Mm.
Tina and Elton have a cousin named Rosalind. I don't care.
Oh no. You said enough right there.
She was complaining at their aunt's funeral. I mean, the lady complains about everything.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, that's one of the things that I don't know if it's the book or Reverend Sharp says that actually complaining is a form of power and control. So when what you just said just verified that. You mm-hmm. give them something to do and they take, it gives them some power and some control. Yes,
it does. They're overboard with it.
Yeah. And it is human nature to complain. So that's why we have to really check it. Every time every time you even start to think about complaining, check and replace it with something to be grateful for.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah, you're right.
So I'm going to ask my family to make a list of 5 things they're grateful for before they get here for Thanksgiving. So we're going to talk about things that we're grateful for, because you pointed out something. We haven't been able to get together, you know, for Thanksgiving in 2 years, really. Is it 2 years or one?
Yeah, I'm just grateful you invited all of us to Thanksgiving.
I already have my 5 list.
We'll be at the Las Vegas airport tomorrow.
Y'all can't be traveling. You ready to get on a plane already? Have you been on?
Las Vegas? We got to come through Vegas. I don't want to.
Oh, you got to come through Vegas.
Jordan, I ain't pushing that wheelchair.
Joyce, that is really good. When I have Thanksgiving, only 1 year I didn't do it, but I usually ask everyone around the table to say something that you are thankful for. Yeah. And I mean, I tell those that don't want to participate, it's okay, because some people don't. Just like me, I'm afraid to speak publicly.
Yeah.
So I allow, if you don't want to say anything, just, it's okay. We'll pass you by, you know. But it's such a good feeling.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
And even the children.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
My grandbaby is 6 years old, and you know, they just made it possible for 5-year-olds and up to 12 to get vaccinated.
Yes.
My little granddaughter called me yesterday. She was like, Gani, look. Now she can do things, she said. I said, well, you know, you were able to do things before, but she said, no, but I'm happy. She was so happy she got that vaccination, because I guess now she feels like she can be free.
Right.
Can you believe a 6-year-old?
Yeah. 6-year-old.
Yeah. She had heard that you need the vaccination to go to your little friend's house, or, you know, children haven't been able to socialize.
No.
So now these children are grateful. The children are grateful. I mean, all living creatures probably are grateful. Yeah. We do have a lot to be grateful for this year.
Exactly. Yes.
Yeah. Amen. Amen.
And just to think that it came just in time.
Yes.
For them to be able to gather, you know, without having to feel any nervousness, you know?
Yes. Because she's got to get on an airplane with a bunch of people.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess she probably heard from her mother that, you know, they really wasn't feeling real free to travel on a plane, because they've driven to here before, but they had not flown in before. These two coming from Northern California, well, the Central Valley. But to me, that was like just awe-inspiring that this little child is grateful to have a vaccination. So now she can feel free.
Mm-hmm. Amen, amen.
I'm gonna write that one down for her myself, in case a mother does. Yeah. Okay, I'm done. it will be nice if we could all get together for some kind of occasion, this Bible study group.
Yeah.
You know?
Amen.
And sit down and fellowship together, because it's like we have become a family.
Exactly. And
God did it.
We're going to claim that that's going to happen soon, Sister Joyce. And I don't know what form is going to happen, but it shall happen. I'm claiming it.
Ask God.
Amen.
Yes.
So I could go through some of the workbook questions, but does anybody else have any good examples about complaining, or any others, anything else to share about complaining?
But I have one that it happened just yesterday.
Okay.
You know, I do the mail for my job. Mm-hmm. And every day I go for like 1 hour walking, taking them into different departments. Mm-hmm. So yesterday I took some mail to the 8th floor, which is the hospital floor. And these are patients suffering from cancer, you know. And anyway, this lady, this patient was up there complaining to everybody that her family told her that they mail her cards and she haven't gotten it yet. What's going on with the mail room? What's happening with the mail? You know, so she was actually on everybody's case yesterday. So when I got up there, they said, we hope you brought something good to keep this patient quiet. So I said, what happened? I said, okay, here's what I have, a stack of mail for this one patient. And they said, boy, you're going to make that patient happy.
Yes.
Because all she has been doing ever since she came in there was complaining. She kept complaining about her family told her what they sent to her. And she didn't receive it, but a package and some cards. And I'm thinking to myself, this lady is a patient in the hospital, in the cancer hospital. And, you know, she should be giving thanks that she's able to get treatment, but instead she's complaining and making everybody's life unhappy, you know? And then I'm preparing to leave the job December 31st. So Human Resources sent me an exit survey yesterday, 2 days ago. I decided to take some time and pray about it before I write anything out of the way. So anyway, been going around delivering and everything like that. I meet a lot of people on a daily basis and I hear all the complaints. I will see people in different places working and they will tell me like, oh, I'm working over here now and I'm happy because that girl over there talks too much about other people, things like that, you know. But I decided to send this letter direct to the source, my complaints, but to the right source, human resources,
mm-hmm.
telling them that I'm leaving. Other people are leaving, coming and people are leaving the job. Nobody's staying. They need to take note of their of the benefits that are giving people. They need to start paying for holidays and they need to increase the salaries that people would be leaving, going on looking for salaries in other places.
Mm-hmm.
And these, I think, were very legitimate complaints because I didn't just like write anything bad. I just told them what was going on and what they need to do. And this is because of the complaints I've been listening to from different employees on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because it's sad to see that so many people have come into the company and they leave, they're not staying.
Mm-hmm.
So to have that retention, they have to do better.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping that they will, because I took it to the right source.
That's right.
So,
mm-hmm.
You're on point, Uncle Mort, you're right.
Yeah.
And you know, one thing that just been on my heart, like since everybody has been, not everybody, since you guys have been mentioning this,
is that people who that's their job, we need to pray for those people.
Yes.
They don't really have a choice. They have, it's like that's a part of what they do. You know, people who, like you said, Cousin Murray, that was your job, taking complaints. People who are involved in unions, that's all it is. It's like people coming to you with their problems. Mm-hmm. Negotiating, because we're going through negotiations at my job for our contract, but that's what's going on. We're expressing the things that we want to be changed, and to the people who can make the changes, and they're saying, okay, why they can or cannot help us, and then we're coming back with that. So, I mean, this is a very important topic that, you know, not mm-hmm. just for the purposes of this study tonight, but in general, I'm gonna start praying for people who have to make decisions, who are like inundated with complaints all the time.
Yes.
I can imagine that being very difficult. I can imagine that's a difficult job to have, and how it can spill over in other parts of a person's life who has to deal with that all the time.
Yeah.
The good thing about my job was that I could speak to the higher ups in any office, because it's a city job, and once they know you're calling from the complaint unit, they allowed you to speak to the director of that program or the person on top, and so you could resolve problems.
Yes.
It was, you know, I could resolve the problem most times, unless they say, well, we can't do this for this person, and then I would have to let the person know that it can't be done. But most times it's be stuff like they apply for Medicaid and their case is just sitting there. Nobody worked on it for months and the people are waiting on their card, you know, stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Or somebody might be waiting on their rent to be paid and the city is holding up the money and, you know, but I was able to contact those people directly. And it really made me feel great when I could help somebody.
Right.
Yes.
So all complaints were not frivolous. A lot of them were actually legitimate complaints.
Yes.
And, you know, if I was an employer, I would try to realize the importance of having the right person to receive the complaints. Because imagine if another person, like a person that didn't have the right spirit was in that place. It can create a lot of chaos within and without. So the right person has to be in position in, you know, in that department.
And I followed it through. I made sure that I followed that one until they answered. Mm. You know, I will call the following day to let the director know it's not done, you know, and I would follow it through. So most people will call and ask for me. But it gives you thought, you know, it made me a little more compassionate.
Mm-hmm.
It did, because I would feel for those people that did not have, sometimes they had all these kids and they couldn't feed their kids because they held up on their food stamps, you know, stuff like that. Most of the calls were legit calls.
Yeah.
It did make me stop taking calls at home. Because I was tired. It was like Tina says, all day. From the time you go in until the end of the day, you got all these calls.
Yeah.
So in the evening when I went home, I didn't want anybody to call me.
I've had enough. You all had enough.
Yeah.
You know, when I was working, there was a co-worker in accounting that she used to do all the receivable. And this lady had a terrible attitude. I'm one of the easiest person to deal with. And she used to be so rude, and I just leave it, you know, okay, whatever. And then, you know, I call other departments and ask them to do this and that. Everybody do things nice and so. But then, like, when we have this annual meeting, every year we have an annual meeting, where all of us, 180-something of us, gather together. We used to call it Team Building Day. That day, when, you know, we do the breakout sessions, because we have different sessions that you could choose which one you want to go. I can for sure say that any session that you go, anyone that you shoot, 4 or 5 people will always say, oh my God, look who is in the class with us. Sherry, her name was, I'm sorry, Sherry, you know, because she was so rude when you call her for anything. So now this time I had to call her because there were one of the members came from, something happened with him and she had to deal with it. She works in accounting. And I don't know if that morning she woke up on the left foot. I don't know how you say that.
The wrong side.
Yeah, it was terrible, you know. And I said, you know, Sharon, you know something? I only call you because I have this member in front of me and he's waiting for an answer. When you finish, if you have an answer, call me or leave a message, because he said he's going to wait. I'm going to put him to sit in the lobby. And she said, okay, I will try to do it now. So I went to my boss and I explained what happened. And this is what my boss said. My boss said, oh, you know, Cheryl is like that. You know, she's like that. She won't do. I said, but the guy is sitting out there and I'm the one that taking all what he's telling, you know. She said, if she don't call you in 5 minutes, come and get me. She didn't call in 5 minutes, so I went back to her. Apparently she, my manager, called her. You know, when it's coming from a manager, she's going to do it. She's not going to do it fast because I'm just like her. You know, I'm in the same position. But my manager called her and know she will do it. So that thing was not resting good with me. So that same day, you know, I was in my break and I said, this thing is not right. So I called her boss. I called the manager of the accounting department and I explained what happened. And the lady says to me, Veronica, this is not the first time, but in this three, because she was new, she had like 3 months in the position. In this 3 months that I have in this position, I have gotten too many complaints about her. The other manager that she had before was her friend and she had her for years, but now she have a new manager. And this new manager wants things to work the right way. We went, I guess they call her attention because everybody in my branch, everybody said, V, you know, have you called Sherry lately? I said, no, I have no reason. Oh, she been so nice. I said, oh, I'm so happy. I'm glad for that. You know, that means the lady, her manager, had to tell her something because something had to be done about her. I don't know how she doing, if she went back to her old trades, but she did a change. Yeah. But you know, I guess I went to the right source. I went to her manager. I went to my manager and my manager said, oh, you know, Cheryl, she will do it. I said, no, but it wasn't right. So I went to her manager.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you know, Antonia, it goes back to, I guess, probably the most important point in all of this is going to the right resource. Mm-hmm. So complaining is not a sin unless you go to the wrong resource. And I was wondering if somebody was going to bring up the example of Moses going to Pharaoh. Israelites had a legitimate complaint with Pharaoh, right? And they went to the right resource, and something even as great as that can get resolved if you go to the right resource.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And if you use the right resources, and you know, the greatest resource that we have is the Lord. You know, he's the greatest resource that we have. The next greatest resource is one another. If we have one another. So sometimes it may not be that I am the person who can resolve the problem, but I know the person who can resolve the problem. So I might be able to go to
to Mama Jordan, because she knows how to actually to get down to the bottom of it. I may not know how to do it, but I know the person who can do that. And the responsible thing would be for me to go to the person who can get me the help that I need to get the matter resolved. So I think one of the most important things about complaining that we can take away from this is that if we do have to complain, go to the right resource and use the right resources to get the matter resolved. And the Moses going to Pharaoh is a great example of both of those, meaning that Moses went to the person who can make the change, and he was working with the person who could ultimately, you know, cause the changes to happen. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's a good example. Right there. Those are great examples of how we should handle complaining.
Yeah, I would say that those people who called me upset would have gone to the center and nothing happened. When they went to the center, they waited and waited and nothing happened. But if they called us, because we were officially the city complainer, once they call us, we have to work on it. We have to give a legit finish to whatever the complaint was.
Yep.
Yeah.
And Brother Elton, he knows about this, that even people who are incarcerated or in detention, they have what they call the grievance process. They can, if something is happening that they don't agree with, they can file a grievance. And sometimes the grievance has cadence and sometimes it doesn't, but there's a person who handles all of those grievances, you know, and it's usually a supervisor or somebody who is not on the line level, somebody who's separated from the line staff and the youth or the people who are, you know, the detainees. That's a better word I could use, the detainees, so that they don't necessarily have a vested interest in what's happening. They just want to get down to the bottom of the matter. Mm-hmm. And, you know, even people incarcerated or locked up, they have the right to complain. And the system is set up to where the complaint goes to the right resource. And it would be foolish for a detainee to go to the person who they're complaining about and trying to get the matter resolved.
That's at that point. Right.
You wouldn't get anywhere. That's so nowhere. You would have to go to the right resource in order to get the matter resolved.
Yeah, and piggyback on that is a lot of times they're complaining, but it turns out into an allegation. You know, yeah, so sometimes they complain about something with so-and-so done to me, but it's turned into an allegation. So now they have to investigate the situation, see what all occurred. So a lot of times, you know, people complain, but also at the same time, most kids don't know if they're complaining or trying to make an allegation, but that's what the process, you know, in terms of somebody complaining, a lot of times it turns into an allegation. And it's an investigation, so yeah. So
that's why I bring it up to them.
I like this lesson.
This was a good lesson.
Yeah, because a lot of times, like you already said, you know, they ain't got no solutions, and you know, they know they can't keep coming to me. Just sometimes, just like some people that gossip. Yep. You know, they know who to go to. And then after a period of time, they know who to go to about the complaints, because they know, like I said, there's got to be some solution at some time or point. Mm-hmm. You ain't got no trying to resolve the situation, then, you know, like you said, your cousin, yeah, it's just one of the things, they just want to be heard. And so you got to have some type of solution. End game, I say sometimes. So,
yeah. Yeah, you know, misery loves company, and so do complainers. You know, the complainer try to get somebody from the other side to turn to their side. You know, bring you in, so it switch you over to the other side.
Yeah, that's why I say. That's why I stay away from that locker room talk. you know, it suck you in and leave you high and dry.
One of the things that the minister said today, and about his, he was admitting that he had this really bad, and that is complaining when you go to a restaurant.
Mm-hmm.
And I have been in company with people who were chronic complainers, whereas was like nothing was right. And they kept, you know, and I finally one time had to say to a friend of mine, I said, if you keep sending your food back,
ooh,
I don't know what they're putting in there.
That's right.
Amen.
You know, stop that. Mm-hmm. I said, because it was like everything that came to the table, she found fault with it, you know? And I said, be careful. And then later on, I read or saw on one of those shows, this girl who said that she used to do that. That she used to complain at, you know, everywhere she went. Mm. But a former waiter says that a lot of times the waiters take that food back and they could do whatever, they could spit in it, whatever, and bring it back to the person, you know? So you have to be careful when you do that.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, Lee complained the water is too cold. They bring it back. It's he wants room temperature water. They took the ice out, but you took the ice out, but it's still cold, you know? But he said, now that he's studying this book, he realizes that he was complaining, doing a lot of complaining. And he said, even his friend knew that, you know, he was doing this. And so the people that are with you or around you tend to get very uncomfortable, as like she said in the book. And, you know, people start to tend to not say anything about it, you know? But it's good if somebody says something, because sometimes you need to stop that kind of behavior.
Yeah, that's right.
I have always been afraid to send it back.
Me too.
I would just either take it home and heat it up for myself or something, you know, because I always feel they'll do something when they take it back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this is a good one.
Something that Mr. Larry said earlier, to ask about it. You were saying that how you used to do this on your job sometime, but you find yourself not doing it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and it drew me back to the notion that every one of these tongues that we study helps us all to go inside of ourselves and create changes, intentional changes.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things I have noticed is that the kinds of phone calls that I used to get that would trigger any kind of gossiping or any kind of criticizing of someone and so on, those things kind of back away from you. I know that partly is the Holy Spirit working with you, but I also think that people begin to notice that you don't do that anymore.
Mm-hmm.
By the way you respond to them, or that you're trying to work on backing away from it, or whatever they notice, they stop calling you and bringing you into that kind of conversation. And I think that's good.
Yes.
I think that's good. They will, you know, because there are things, I know there are times when conversations go on, and months later, I'll hear someone, well, you didn't hear about that? I, no, I didn't. And it's obvious that nobody, so they thought, well, I won't bother to bring it to her because she's not going to entertain it, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think that's good because that's the way we want to grow. And, you know, I'm not saying that I'm perfect here because I have a whole lot of flaws from all of those tongues.
Well, you know, a good example. Work on it. A good example of that was, you know, I was taken back to the gossiping tongue recently when I was in California, when Azrael tested positive. And that particular Thursday, I was going to be able to go to Bible studies because because I had to cancel my hair appointment. I said, oh, well, since I'm here, I might as well call into Bible studies. So I dial the number and everything, and I'm sitting there just listening as these people, the women are just talking back and forth, greeting each other and what have you. And I didn't announce myself, I'm just listening. And so, you know, I'm reaching now to get my notebook and my Bible so that I can start taking notes when the teacher comes on the line. And one of the ladies says, oh, I have a prayer request. Usually they have prayer requests at the end of the class. This person said, I have a prayer request. And everybody's listening. She says, is Joyce Jordan on the line? But you know, I was on mute. That's another thing. I was on mute. Is Joyce on the line? And you know, so I didn't get to answer quick enough. And this person started to give a prayer request for my family.
On your behalf.
On my behalf. And I remembered in the gossiping tale how it said that, you know, some people go to Bible studies or what have you, and they offer up prayer requests for other people without getting permission to do it. So I hurriedly got unmuted, and I says, this is Joyce. And everything is fine. My grandson is doing fine. We're all, you know, I says, he's fully vaccinated. He tested positive, and we're all doing what we're supposed to do. And I was going to call her later on and say, I did not ask you. No, because I sent a message to my circle, and this person took it upon herself to make this announcement. And I thought, she was gossiping. I don't think she probably realized it, because people tend to want to, as soon as they hear something, they think they have to take it to a group. You know, but that was so funny. You should have seen me scrambling to unmute my phone. I'm here. Let me, if I want to give that report, let me give it.
Right.
You know.
Right. We're getting close to the time to end. I don't want to stop without giving everybody one opportunity to make your comment, if you have not, or if you would like to add anything else. Now would be a good time to do that.
Yes.
Okay, well, the last thing that I would like to say is, excuse me, you just referenced this, Mom, that this book, Mom and Aunt Marvin, you guys both just referenced that this book helps us or causes us to do self-reflection, you know, to look within. And when we go through this information, later on, we recognize it, you know, when we see it. And so, for example, you notice the gossiping tone, that, oh, that lady is gossiping. And before, you may not have, you know, put that together. Yes. But what this book is helping us to do is raise our awareness of things that are going on. And once we are aware of something, then we can see it. We can recognize it. And when we're aware of something, then we can manage it. So we can't manage what we can't measure. So now we're measuring the amount of, you know, whatever it is, whatever kind of tone that we experience, whether it be we notice somebody is self-absorbed, whether we notice somebody is boasting or whatever it might be. And it's because of our awareness of it. And once we are aware of something, we start to see it more often. Yes. So that's called our reticular activation system, RAS. And it's the example that was given to me that helps me to remember what the reticular activation system is if you're, you just purchase a car and you're like, wow, I like that green Jaguar. Once you see that green Jaguar, the next thing you know, that for the next couple of days, you start to see it everywhere. And it's not that they just pop up, it's just that you're starting to see, recognize it because of your reticular activation system is kicking in. Another example that they used, and this was the demonstration, not example, this is the demonstration that they used. They said, okay, think of the color brown. Now look around the room. You know, they start to see different things that are the color brown, when at first they didn't notice all the brown things in the room. But once you say, okay,
think about the color brown, and then you start to look around the room, you start to notice all the things that are brown. That's your reticular activation system. This book causes our reticular activation system to kick in because we've studied this, and now we see, look at that there. Oh, look at that there. That's retaliating. Oh, that's self-absorbed. Oh, that's boasting. That's, that these are the things and that we're growing. These are the areas that we're growing in. And once we can
pick up things,
measure something, then we can manage it. So we see ourselves doing some of those things, gossiping or being boastful, then we can manage. So this is helping on so many different levels.
Yeah.
I can see that everybody else agrees with me when I say that, and everybody comments has led to that same understanding. So I just wanted to give you that little bit because that came to me during this last week's study, so the reticular activation system. All right, so that was the last bit of that I had, and if does anybody else have anything? Because otherwise, I'm going to ask because Myrna to have the closing comments, and then I was going to ask for Mama Jordan to close us in prayer after Cousin Myrna's closing comments.
Before she speaks, I just want to know if you have who down for next week.
Yes, let me. Hold on, I can get that quicker on my phone. Give me one second.
I don't show.
I think it's me, but I'm not sure.
Okay, let me see. Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
Oh, okay.
It is.
All right. Okay. Thank you.
Retaliating tongue.
Yeah. I've been studying. But yes. I just wanted to make sure that you had it down for me.
Yes, okay. That is correct. Yes, thank you for reminding me of that. Thank you for reminding me.
Well, Larry.
Yes.
I have a question. Since that's the Wednesday of Thanksgiving, we are having one.
Oh, that's right.
That is something to consider. I'm going to make myself available. But what do you guys think? How does everybody else, how does the group think we should handle it?
Traveling,
we should just move it to the next.
Yeah, day. We can move it because I'll be going back and forth.
Right.
Family.
The airport and all of that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I'm cooking, so.
Okay. Well, that sounds good. We're in agreement then.
Thinking about that.
The following Wednesday.
December 1st.
Yes.
Okay. All right.
And we'll postpone until the following week. Thank you guys for bringing that up. And, I'm glad we're in agreement. And we talked about it now. So everybody who's on board, who's online now, we'll be able to be on the same page.
Yes.
Okay. All righty.
Okay.
All right.
All I can say is I'm going to thank you all for allowing me to do what I did today.
Amen.
I really didn't think it would happen, but it did, and I'm thankful to God. I don't have a closing to say. I could say a prayer because that's all I do, say prayers, but I don't have one that would come up in my head. Mm-hmm. So, I love Psalm 27. That's my prayer. So, if it's okay, I'll try to say that for you.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
Mm-hmm.
When evildoers advance against me, to devour my flesh. It's my adversaries and foes who would stumble and fall. Though an army, oh Lord, you know I'm afraid. I say this all the time.
It camps against me.
Yes. My heart will not fear.
Though war break out against me, even then I'll be confident. One thing I ask from the Lord, that only would I seek
Take your time.
I am sorry I say it every day, but I'm going to bring it out because I know it's just because I'm afraid. And I thank you all for your patience.
Yes.
Here it comes. And just need to have it in front of me.
Yes, all right.
Okay.
That's all right.
One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
Yeah.
To gaze at the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple.
Yeah.
For the days of trouble, he would keep me safe in his dwelling. He would hide me in the shelter of his sacred tent and set me high upon a rock. Then my head would be exalted above the enemies who surround me. At his sacred tent, I would sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord. Hear my voice when I call, Lord. Be merciful to me and answer me. My heart says of you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. Though my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will receive me. Teach me your way, Lord. Lead me in a straight path because of my oppressors. Do not turn me over to the desire of my foes, for false witnesses raise up against me, spouting malicious accusations.
Yes.
I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord. Amen, amen, and amen.
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 Well, I mean, you know what, Mom? I think we could say that is a closing prayer right there.
Amen.
Amen. And I want to take the time to, again, thank you, Cousin Myrna, for your diligence, for your time, for your effort, and for your expertise, because you did that like a seasoned veteran.
You never know.
You've never done it before, but unless you told me, we couldn't do it.
No God,
even from the use of your scripture, your interjection during the conversation, and the way you ended this with prayer again is commendable.
Yes. She's a loner too.
Amen.
Thank you.
So thank you again.
Thank you.
And thank you, everybody.
It's your beautiful baby.
Thank you.
Yes, yes. So with that being said, until we meet again, I love you. And
have a safe Thanksgiving.
Have a happy Thanksgiving, everybody.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Thanksgiving.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Traveling grace as well, if you're traveling during that time.
Yeah.
And if your families who are traveling in, you know, in coming into town, praying for traveling grace for everyone.
Yes.
Yeah. I just want to thank you all for praying.
Dad's visit goes well with you, Larry, and with family.
Mm.
Thank you.
We know it's gonna work out wonderfully.
Yes.
Thank you.
So you get your milkshakes ready, because he's the one of
those. Yes. Sister Joyce, you were saying something. I'm sorry.
Well, I was gonna say I really appreciate your prayers for the past 2 weeks for my husband. I know Joyce told you all about my husband. Mm-hmm. He's doing a little better. So we thank God that he's able to get up and walk now. He can do a little bit without the crutches, but not without the cane yet. So he's still on the cane. But he's getting there. He's feeling good.
Amen.
Yes. Thank
Amen.
God. Yes.
Praise
all
God.
Right.
Praise God.
Well, thank you guys. God bless you. and you have a blessed night and Thanksgiving and everything. And until we meet again.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. All right.
One minute.
Wait.
Yes, go right ahead.
Okay.
Since we're getting rid of the negative.
Yeah. I was about to go to sleep.
I'm gonna try to play something for Thanksgiving.
Amen. Okay.
I'm in the right spirit. Time to let us. He can't.
Is that we gather together?
Yes.
Gather together to ask our blessing. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody.
Happy Thanksgiving.
We will now.
Yeah.
Look at us. Coming in a little
now. Uncle Mark, you just made his day.
Yes. It's been 3 weeks.
Okay, bye, you guys.
Gina. Don't let him stand up in the middle of your table and say, we gather together.
All right, everybody have a blessed.
I'll be right up there. Good night.
Larry, you're going to have to cut us off. Nobody wants to go.
Keep it going. You know?
No, we need to go.
I know.
Good night.
All right, love you guys. Good night.
Good night.